Okay, so without apology, I'll switch to English if it's okay. Thank you very much for the introduction. And I'm going to be talking today not about the kind of modern social networks many of you are familiar with, like Facebook and so forth, but instead I'm going to be talking about the real ancient social networks, the kind of social networks human beings have been making for hundreds of thousands of years. And I'm interested in how it comes to be that we embed ourselves in these phenomenally complicated structures that affect so many aspects of our lives. Now, for me, this story began about 15 years ago. And at the time, I was a hospice doctor taking care of terminally ill patients and their families. So I would go into their homes, I would carry my little black bag, and I was taking care of them as these people were dying. And I was observing how illness in one person affected the other people in the family, how it might be that when I'm dying, it affects those around me. And in my lab, I was studying something known as the widower effect, which is also known as dying of a broken heart. And it's a phenomenon which has been described for over 150 years, first beginning in 1858 in England, where some scientists observed that when one person dies, their partners, their wives or their husbands' risk of death goes up afterwards. Like this couple here, for example. Now, one day I was taking care of a woman who was dying of dementia, and she, unlike this couple, was being taken care of by her daughter. And the daughter was exhausted from taking care of her mother. And the daughter's husband had become sick from his wife's exhaustion. And I was driving home from taking care of this woman one day, and I get a phone call on my cell phone from the husband's best friend, who's calling me because he's depressed about what's happening to his friend. So here's this random guy that's calling me as a result of something that's happening at some degree removed from him. And I suddenly made two very simple observations. First, the widowhood effect is not restricted to husbands and wives. It can also involve other types of people, other pairs of people. And second, it's not even restricted to pairs. It can actually spread from one person to another, to another, to another, not just from one person to the first person. And so, in fact, we might have a kind of non-biological spread of disease, a kind of sociological spread of these types of phenomena. And I came to see the world in a completely new way, like this. Here are two people, the mother and the daughter, or the husband and the wife, represented by the two dots, and a line that connects them. And in fact, here is the chain of the four people, and now we can add other pairs of people that are near them, other couples nearby, and all of these people might be connected to still other people by ties of friendship or coworker, you know, work or family, connected to all kinds of other people. And I realized that the pairs of people that I had been studying, the widower effect and so on, was actually a special case of a much broader phenomena, that we could begin to understand people as being connected in a much vaster way than just one person connected to another. And we could begin to understand influence as spreading not just from one person to another, but across many much larger social networks. And in fact, these social networks are vast. They're enormous. And I became obsessed with this topic. I became obsessed with the idea that one could understand a bunch of fundamental questions about social science and about medicine and about our common humanity. Because social networks are intricate things of beauty, and they are so elaborate and so complex and so ubiquitous, in fact, but one has to ask a certain set of questions. One has to ask what purpose they serve. I mean, why are we embedded in social networks? Why do we form social networks? How do they work? And how do they affect us? It cannot be a coincidence that human beings not only make social networks, but make social networks that look like this. So here are some of the questions I'd like to explore with you today. I'd like to start by talking to you a little bit about artificial social networks, the kinds of social networks humans make deliberately, and then talk to you about some of our work on natural social networks, the kind of social networks we just form organically. Then I'm going to make some remarks about our new hyperconnected world, what the internet and other types of modern telecommunications might mean for our network interactions. I'm going to speak to you about some of our work on the genetics of human social networks, and then I'm going to close with some general remarks on networks and the human condition. Now, first of all, What's the difference between a group and a network? Here we have just a group of people on the left, and on the right, 100 dots representing these people, 100 red dots. Well, the difference is that a group has specific ties that join, that connect the people to each other. And these ties add something. There's something in addition to the human beings that are members of the group. And there are two kinds of networks, artificial networks and natural networks. And here's one example of a very simple artificial network of 100 people that are organized into a bucket brigade. So we take these 100 people and we make them into a simple linear network. We add 99 ties. Each person is connected to two other people. And now when we organize the human beings in this way, they're able to do something that the 100 people previously could not do, like transport water to put out a fire. So this group, because of the ties, has a property, this putting out the fire property, that wasn't present in the group before we added the ties. Or we could take the same individuals, 100 people, and have, again, 99 ties, and organize them completely differently now in the form of a telephone tree. This is something old-fashioned, before the internet. So if you wanted to let someone know that a school was closed, you notified one person. That person in the middle called two people. Each of those two people called two people. And this network is now organized for the rapid and accurate dissemination of information. Okay? Same 100 people, same number of ties, completely different structure, completely different function of the network. The network now has, again, properties that weren't present in the individuals. Or we could take the same 100 people, now with a larger number of ties, 450 ties, and organize them into the form of a military company, 100 men, with 10 groups of 10 men. And this network is designed in a fashion that's so powerful that these soldiers will die for each other. We can take this network and add a certain pattern of ties which will encourage a kind of valor that wouldn't exist if we just had individuals acting independently. Now, real social networks differ in shape and in appearance, and nowadays also in size, than the kind I've been showing you. So this is an example of a natural social network, which has a particular kind of structure, very different than the structures that I've just shown you, but which still obeys certain very fundamental mathematical rules, which one can begin to uncover and discover. What are the kind of mathematical rules or laws that govern the assembly and the function of human social networks? This network is one that we began to study in 2002, and this is a network of people. Every dot is a person. Every line connecting them is a relationship between the two people. And here, there are 2,200 people in the year 2000, and we make the dot size proportional to people's body size. So bigger dots are bigger people. And in addition, if they're properly obese, we color the dots yellow. So very big people are colored yellow. And this is one of the images we made to begin to study how obesity might spread in human social networks. So we began this work in 2002 because it had become popular in the United States and perhaps also in Greece to speak of the obesity epidemic. And it's clear that obesity was epidemic in one meaning of the word, meaning that there was more obesity now than there used to be. But we wondered whether obesity could be understood as epidemic in another meaning of the word. Was it actually spreading from person to person? Was there a kind of contagion where my gaining weight causes people around me to gain weight, which causes people around them to gain weight, and you can have a kind of spreading process within the network? So to study this, we had to develop a special kind of data that didn't exist before, where we had information on people's social networks followed across time, and information on their weight measured every few years, so we could study this process. But the complexity of this network is still very high, visually speaking. And in many cases, several questions are raised by this clustering, even if you agree with me that when you look at this network, you might see clusters of obese and non-obese people. You have to ask the question, is there more clustering than is due to chance? Maybe it's just random that there's some clustering. How big are the clusters?